Hello, everybody, and welcome to episode 28 of Magic FM. I'm Gabby Spartone, your host today, and I'm joined by Mashi Scanlon. Mashi, welcome. How are you?
I'm doing great. How are you doing?
I'm awesome. I have been very excited about this episode, just so that people know. We've been talking about this episode for a while, and we said that in one of these weeks when there was not a lot of magic news, we would do the conspiracy theories episode, and it is this week.
So I was so excited. I was like slacking Gabby. I was like, and I wanted to pitch it right away. I was like, so slow magic news week, huh?
I wonder what that means, ellipsis.
Yeah, I was like, conspiracy episode. Because I have no idea about any of these conspiracies, right? I've heard tons of different ones about live gameplay and Grand Prix and stuff. None of them which I've ever had been true. But so I'm so excited that, that there's all these arena conspiracies.
Yeah, there's a lot of stuff. And so I want everybody at home to know this. I specifically forbid Mashi from looking at our show notes document, because what I wanted to do is I wanted to put everything in there, and then I'm going to do a quiz. So
God. Okay. Now so, I got to think.
I know. I didn't want you to know that this was going to happen. So basically the way the quiz is going to go, and I would like for people at home to follow along, is I'm going to tell you what the conspiracy theory is. Like, what was the stuff that made people think that this was true? Or like, what was the evidence to suggest that this was a thing? Then I'm going to ask you if you think it's real or not, because some of the conspiracy theories we have on here actually turned out to be real.
Oh my God, no.
There's a few that are actual factual. Sounds super like, wow, I can't believe you're saying that, but it is actual factual. Was real, like it was a real bug, or were things that were actually happening that were later confirmed.
Okay. I'm into it. This is good. Wow, this is like, you know, the you know, fake or not or whatever.
Yeah. That's what's gonna happen. And I want people, I will also, like, at the end of each one of these, kind of pause and ask you to figure out if you think it's real or not, and then people at home can also kind of like pause, think about whether or not they think it's real or not, and like let us know how they did.
Yes. Yeah. No cheating. You gotta be honest.
No cheating. You have to try to guess with the information that I give you whether or not this thing is real or not.
This is exciting.
Yeah, I know. I think it's gonna be really fun. But before we get into the episode, let's do a shout out for the sponsor of the podcast, channelfireball.com. We have a cool new thing that just actually launched today. And CFB Pro, which we've talked about plenty on the podcast, did not launch today, but something cool did launch today for CFB Pro, and it's affiliate codes for influencers. Magic FM doesn't really have one. The code that we're using is just Gabby. But basically the way it works, it's an affiliate code, so you don't actually get a discount if you sign up to CFB Pro, but if you use the code when you're signing up, the CFB keeps track of that, and then that gives a kickback to whatever influencer whose code you're using. So if you're using Gabby, it'll be me. If it's anybody from Team CFB, you can use like Huey's code, you can use Luis's code, you can use Video for Andrea, and they're all gonna
I love how everybody does know Mengu's code.
Oh yeah, it's just Mengu, so obvious that it should be Video. It's Video. Yeah,
that's the Mengu code. Everybody knows it.
So. Yeah, no, it's fantastic. It's really good. But that's the way those affiliate codes work. So if you're already going to be signing up for CFB, or CFB Pro rather, if that's something you're already interested in, it would be awesome if you used, you know, like your favorite influencer's code. And this is not just going to be Team CFB. There's going to be other influencers who are going to be in there as well. So be on the lookout for stuff like that. It's a really easy way for you to support some of your favorite content creators. Not just that, this also works on the website. So it's basically the exact same way. It will also work on your Magic card purchases from CFB. So that's rolling out today. I would super love it if you use the code Gabby. But if you're going to use any code like that, you should definitely use the code if you're already going to do it, because it's an awesome and basically free way of supporting your content creators.
And it's a great way, you know, because I'm on both sides of this, but it's a great way to let what you said, you know, Channel Fireball looks at this, and we do. And it's a great way to kind of like vote for the content you like. Like, we know, oh, hey, Gabby, everybody loves Gabby. Everyone's using Gabby's code. That's awesome. We got to keep Gabby going, you know. No one uses LSV. No one likes Luis. Maybe we got to get Luis off the website. You know, stuff like that.
Yeah. No, this is the way a lot of like affiliate marketing and a lot of affiliate codes work just on the general internet. So it's just something to keep in mind, because this isn't just true with magic products. This is true with a lot of other things. If you have, there's like podcasts you consume, if there's Twitch streams mm-hmm. you watch, if you're going to be buying that stuff already, there's almost always a way you can get an affiliate code or some sort of discount code from influencers that work with them. So that is, it's a really good thing for you to be on the lookout for, because it does help the content creator a lot, and it sometimes gets you a discount too. So just a good pro tip, you know. All right, Mosh, are you ready for some conspiracy theories? The truth is out there.
It's so funny because normally we burn some time with nonsense, but it's like, no, let's just get to it.
Yeah, we always have a bunch of nonsense.
Well, so.
I mean, I wasn't going to kick off a nonsense episode without a little...
The tinfoil hat. If you are not watching the video, so obviously this is a podcast, Magic FM is a podcast, but the videos are available on channelfireball.com and YouTube. You missed Gabby with her tinfoil hat. I love it.
I did a bad job because it doesn't actually stay on my head, but you just got to imagine. It's a crappy tinfoil hat, not big enough to stay on my head, but good enough for the podcast right now.
Let me just set it down. It's a hat made for radio.
So yes. Yeah, specifically. Ooh, baby. All right. Okay, so I want to mention something just to lay the groundwork for some of these conspiracy theories. So for some of these conspiracy theories, and generally with conspiracy theories, there's a nugget of truth to them. Like something has to have happened for you to kind of get the inkling of like, huh, I wonder if this thing is going on, right? So yeah, a lot of conspiracy theories, like the tinfoil hat joke is real because so many of them are just so far from the truth. But some of these, a lot of these have just this much truth to them that it makes it feel like, oh, maybe this is what's happening. And the other thing I wanted to add in here is that people are very bad at like statistics and probability and recognizing what randomness looks like. Because, and this is like where the mana weaving thing comes in, where people say like, oh, of course my deck was random after I shuffled it. I had a mix of lands and spells. But true randomness doesn't look like that. Sometimes true randomness looks like four questing beasts next to each other because that can just happen, right? So you just got to keep that in mind, that people are not very good at like being, like people see patterns where there aren't some. People are not very good at recognizing what randomness looks like. And things that sometimes look kind of weird are actually just the way things are and not weird at all. So keep that in mind as I read these off to you. Ready?
My favorite example of this, by the way, is iPods and Apple Music, iTunes. They have a random function.
The shuffle? Yeah.
And it used to be a true random, totally shuffled, which by the way means you could listen to the same song three times in a row.
It could happen. And that would actually be random. Yeah.
But now if you hit shuffle, they will not play back-to-back songs.
That's funny. So it's actually random.
they had to de-random it because people thought, wait a minute, this isn't random. I just listened to this song. How can that be? But the fact is, that is what being truly random is.
Wow, right? that's such a good example. I'm so glad you mentioned that. That is what's going on here too. Like some of the stuff, it's random that it happened, but people feel like it can't possibly be random because how weird of a coincidence.
Yeah, it could never happen that way. Truly random would never happen that way.
Yeah,
so, okay.
Exactly.
Let's do it.
I'm ready. All right. So this is the first one. For posterity, for everything that I have, like the Reddit posts were initiated or people collecting evidence and stuff like that, I'll include everything in the show notes. I don't have it for every single thing because some of these things are things that I know I've read and I wasn't able to find the Reddit post afterward, or I just heard it from other people. So I don't have like the quote evidence of where it originated.
It's originating here? What? This is the start of it. This is not that. Now this is sounding like your own conspiracy.
My own conspiracy theory.
Like, I don't have the evidence, but I read it somewhere.
The evidence is out there.
You just have to believe me. Okay. I like where this is. Yeah. Conspiracies inside conspiracies.
Yeah. The other thing I did want to do a big shout out for is people on my Discord who I told them that I was doing this episode, and people went and helped me find where a lot of these things initiated and ones that I hadn't even heard of myself. So thanks to everybody who hustled and helped me find all the like Reddit threads, the arena posts, like all in like the dev forums and stuff where some of this happened. I will make sure that everything's linked in the show notes. All right. Here's the first one.
Let's go.
Ooh. The first one was that ICRs were not random. So ICRs are individual card rewards, and they're the rewards that you get on Arena when you play random stuff. So let's say you play a league, you win your game, and every time you get games, like every so often wins, you would get one card. And you would be told what kind of card it would be. Like, you would know if it were going to be an uncommon, or if it was a common, or if it was a rare. Like, rares happen less often. Like, they happen every 10 wins or something. So people started getting card rewards, and they would always be like, I feel like I got that always. Like, I'm always getting this card. And this is frustrating, because when you get a copy of an uncommon that you have, you don't get anything for it. You get progress added towards your vault, which eventually opens up and gives you, like, wild cards. But getting one of those is just basically worthless. Like, it's so much worse than getting a normal card that you don't own, because that way you're growing your collection. So people collected all this evidence about ICRs not being random, and they posted it onto Reddit. And and people went digging to try to figure out if this was real or not. All right, so that's this one. Okay. Mashi, take a second.
Can I ask a question?
You can totally ask questions.
So was the evidence for this that, hey, it's not random because I already got this card, and Arena, the devs are trying to screw me out of, like, extra cards by popping up the same card over and over?
Yeah. So it was two things. The first one was they're deliberately, like, Wizards is deliberately doing this so that we don't get to grow our collections. That way we have to spend more money on Arena. That was, like, the more malicious one. The other one were people saying, like, no, I think the whatever mechanism Wizards use to give individual card rewards is bugged. And that's why I'm seeing the same card over and over again.
Ooh, God.
All right. So is this one true or not?
So option two you gave isn't really a conspiracy, right? Because I feel like you need that you need some kind of motive for there to be a conspiracy. That's a random bug in the thing.
Sure.
I'm going to say the ICRs were actually random. This was not they were totally random, kind of like the iPod thing, and people just kept hitting the same song over and over. So I say, what am I saying? The conspiracy is fake.
You're saying the conspiracy is fake.
There is no conspiracy here.
All right, drum roll. It's real. It was actually real. So there was a bug in the mechanism that gave you the ICRs. And the mechanism actually made you get some of the commons and uncommons more often than others. And the reason it was proven to be, like, a real thing, like, it was a real bug, is because later Arena posted on their dev forums, we fixed this problem.
They called themselves out.
Yeah, they were like, we fixed the problem. And then people were like, we knew it. We knew it was real. So then so a new Reddit thread gets made, and we're like, we won. Oh my God.
Validation.
We're validated. I can't believe we got there. And everyone in there is just still making fun of the people who, like, were so gung-ho about it, because they're like, listen, a clock's going to be right twice.
Twice a day. Sure.
Because they're saying, well, you guys complain about everything. You're going to have to be right about something at some point.
This is so dangerous, though. All you have to do is validate a conspiracy.
One of them, right?
To validate every conspiracy, right?
Yeah.
Because then it just becomes, they were okay admitting to that one, but they don't want to admit to this.
Exactly.
One.
But this one was a legitimate bug, so they actually patched it up. And then they said that they had, and people just had a field day. Reddit was just so happy because they were proven right.
Yes. So many life's works were validated that day.
Yeah. I mean, you can't, almost everybody that posts on these, like, conspiracy theory threads, all they have is anecdotal evidence. Like, you just don't have numbers to really prove this. You just say, I feel like I got the same reward five times. Yeah, definitely it's happening. So when people are saying that, other people are saying, like, no, you're just seeing patterns where there aren't any. But actually,
this was legit. This was legit. Pattern.
Yeah.
Okay. I missed that one.
All right. Conspiracy theory number two. The MTGO draft cabal. So I think I've mentioned this one to you a little bit.
I love this
This was my favorite one because it's just it's so elaborate. All right. So the MTGO draft cabal works as follows. It is a group of Magic players, professional Magic players, to be clear, that, like, pros who get together at midnight. We don't know midnight what time, but that's supposed to be the time when people get together. They get together at midnight to draft the current set. Or it could be cube, it could be anything, just a draft format. And they all join the queue at the same time so that they can see that they're all in the pod together. And when you're actually in Magic Online, once you're in the pod, you can see who else is in the draft pod with you.
Yep.
So once you've already done that, you determine who's where and you open your rare and you see that you open like a busted red rare. So you tell the people to your left and to your right to leave red open because then you'll be able to get all the good red cards. And so the whole thing is everyone's in one video chat together, making sure that everyone's in different archetypes. So that way, instead of you ending up, you know how like sometimes people like rare draft a really good rare. Mm-hmm. They're like, I just don't want, yeah. You know, like I want this for my collection or I don't want to pass this. Or like, what if I splash it? This basically optimizes the draft so that everybody in the draft format is going to have the best deck for their seat possible. And then the second part of the draft cabal includes people then play the decks the next day, but they all make sure they play at different times. So that way they are optimizing so that they don't run into each other.
They don't want to be in the same league game.
Exactly. They don't want to be in the same league game. So you're making sure that people have different records, are in different time zones and playing at different times so you don't cannibalize the draft cabal. And then that way everybody maximized to the best draft deck and to get the most wins.
Oh my God, this is awesome.
So that's a conspiracy theory. And part of this was born from people saying like, every time I play against like these pro players, their deck is so good. How do they have such a good deck? The only way this could be explained is if people are doing the draft cabal.
Oh my God.
All right, Mosh and everyone at home. Do you think the MTGO draft cabal is real?
let me consult my notes here because I have talked to Luis about this.
Yeah.
Hey, Mosh.
Somebody who would clearly be part of the draft cabal.
If you want to join the draft, let me know an hour ahead of time. Remember, first rule of draft cabal, you don't talk about
the draft cabal.
Okay. I'm going to say no draft cabal as I've been instructed to by Luis and Huey and Martin.
Oops. I tried to put my hat on again, but it didn't work.
And everybody else. This is going to be a hard pass for me. Just make sure Luis said I said no cabal.
Yeah. All right. So my verdict with this one is the pro players are definitely not doing it, but there is a non-zero chance that people have tried to do this out there.
Sure. I could see this being a thing among you know, eight friends. Actually, that's a really good point. So the draft cabal doesn't exist. Because, like, look, we know a lot of top Magic players. There's just, like, just take it, there's zero chance.
There's zero chance the pro players are doing this. They would never waste their time on this. Because it's also so, the like effort to coordinate the draft cabal is so much more work than just like playing an extra league on Magic Online, you know? They would just never go through the trouble.
And for anyone who thinks this is real, just ask yourself a question. Luis is the player on the right. Do you really think he's going to coordinate with you, or do you think he's gonna jam right into your color and
do the bait and switch?
Absolutely. And he's not the only player that would do that to you, so yeah, there's just no way. And I mean,
no way, right?
Yeah, nobody got the patience or time for that. Like, I'm also not gonna wait.
You wouldn't even necessarily be able to pull it off well. Like, what happens if you both open like a really busted red rare and then it's like, okay, well, you're gonna end up with a deck that's way better than mine because I'm gonna pass you my busted red rare so that I take what, the uncommon blue card? I don't know, like, it just falls apart in so many ways. But there's so many people out there who play Magic Online that there is a chance that there has been some sort of draft cabal that did try to do this to maximize their decks and then played the next day to try to get more wins.
And this is where we talk about, you reference this, right? The conspiracy has a kernel of truth.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
And so maybe they just hit on the wrong group of players. But, and please don't try this. Just play Magic and have fun.
Yes, we do. Magic FM does not endorse the draft cabal. Yeah. Do not go out there and try it.
When you try doing stuff like this, having fun becomes so secondary that when it doesn't come off, you just feel awful and frustrated and terrible. So no draft cabal, but yes, definite conspiracy. Do not believe it exists.
Yeah, agreed. But it is funny because people out there are like, these pros have decks that are too good. They're clearly in the cabal together, which I have heard. I've literally heard stuff like that.
Wow. There's a reason they're pros. They are very good at Magic.
Yeah, yeah. They are also just very good at Magic and good drafters. Yeah. So maybe on average their deck is good. I don't know. Exactly. It's just like too logical of an explanation. Probably.
Exactly. Occam's razor there.
All right. Here's the next one.
Okay.
This one believes that if you win too much on MTGA, on Arena specifically, Wizards will flag your account. And then you start getting put on the draw more often so that you start, because, you know, being on the draw is like, or being on the play is a pretty big advantage. So you, if you're winning too much, your account gets flagged, you get put on the draw more often until you start losing some. And then when you start losing a lot, you get put on the play more often. That's, and the evidence for this is just people being like, every time I start winning, I get on the draw a lot. Why is this happening? Wow. Do you think this is a real win or not?
I'm going to take a moment to consider. No. First of all, I am not winning a lot on MTGA, and I find myself on the draw. So maybe it doesn't work that way. Maybe it's only if you win too much you're on the, but no, there's just no way.
So this one specifically believes that if you win too much, that's when you get put on the draw.
But losing too much doesn't automatically get you to play first.
No. As far as I know, if you're winning too much, you get put on the draw, but that's it. That's like
it's
the
just punch. A negative, not a positive.
Yes.
No, just absolutely not. Absolutely not. There's just like no way I could buy. And by God, if there are dev notes saying this, heads need to roll, like you would ever say this is happening, but no.
So drum roll. This one's fake. Okay. This one's fake. By fake, when I say fake, it means that there's no evidence to suggest this is actually happening other than people feeling like this is happening to them. Sure. So clearly there's a lot of people out there who feel like this is happening to them, and that's why the conspiracy theory exists. But there's nothing to indicate that this is real. Not at all. It's just people getting salty because they're now losing. Because they're like, oh, I've always been on the draw the entire tournament. How could this have happened? And it's like, I don't know. You were probably on the draw 70% of the times and you felt like you lost every single die roll. Mm-hmm.
So if I'm hearing you correctly, Gabby, you're not saying it's fake. You're just saying we haven't found the proof.
I'm saying the truth is out there, Maj.
Yes, right. Exactly. we haven't found the proof.
Yes, we haven't. The proof might be out there. But so far, I am inclined to believe that there is no amount of truth to this.
I am with you.
All right. Here's the next one.
Okay, let's hear it.
Oof. Okay. So this one has happened in, or like the people who are talking about this have said it's happening in both Pauper and Vintage.
Okay, Pauper and Vintage.
So this one is about win trading. And for those who are not familiar with win trading, to explain what it is, the idea is that if you have two accounts on Magic Online that play against each other, and one only wins and the other one only loses, so you know, you get 20 tickets and play points for the person who goes 0-5, and you get, if you go 5-0 in the other account, you get a trophy, 22 tickets, 150 play points, and QPs. Oof. So basically, if you join with two accounts and you successfully pair them against each other so that one goes 5-0 and the other one goes 0-5, you can technically profit from that because you're making more money because you're guaranteeing that you're always going to go 5-0. Okay. And it's a really easy way to rack up QPs. Now, how does this work, right? Because you're like, oh, I'm just going to join a league. How could I ever make sure that I get paired up against the other account? That's where the Pauper and Vintage piece comes in. When you queue up against somebody on Magic Online, you get a confirmation window that says join the match. If you join two accounts against each other and it's a league that is not very full, you could actually see, if you have two windows, monitors open, you can see both accounts show the announcement that says you've joined the match. And that's how you know they're paired up against each other. Okay. I'm blowing Mashi's mind.
Okay. No, if you're not watching this, there's a huge visual element to this, right?
Because
on the podcast, I'm just being quiet, but I'm like, it's just
Mashi's like slowly like realizing like, oh my God, that actually would work.
There's levels. Right? There's levels, right?
So, exactly. So the reason people started suspecting this was happening is because the Pauper and the Vintage queues, they're not super popular. They are more niche formats. To play Vintage, you have to like have a pretty big collection. To play Pauper, there's just like, it's just a smaller format. There's not that many more people playing. So the trophy races in these formats are actually like, people pay attention to them because it's like, oh, I know that person. It's kind of like old school Magic. You like know all the names on the leaderboard. Sure. You know all the people who are like part of the community. And in fact, many of these communities like the Pauper and Vintage, they have Discords where the people who play those leagues often talk amongst each other. And so there's been people who showed up at the top of the leaderboard and people were like, who is this person? No one here has ever played against them. Could it be win trading? So that's the conspiracy theory, Maj. I'm going to give you a second and everyone at home to wonder, is this actually, did this actually happen or not?
Do I think so? I think this is a conspiracy. I don't think this happens on, you know, this is a widespread thing. Like, this is what do I think someone has attempted this and maybe gotten a few rounds out of it? Yes, I think this is something someone has attempted. Do I think it has been successful or is widespread? No, I do not.
Sure. Drum roll. This one's real.
Get out of here.
This happened in Popper, and there was a huge investigation because people were like, there's no way. This person is not a real person. We know every person who plays the Popper matches.
Get out of here.
It actually happened. And the reason it worked was because of what I just mentioned, the fact that two windows would pop up at the same time. So if you didn't want to queue up against that person, if you realized that the two accounts weren't paired against each other, you would just exit the queue and then do it again. And so there were accounts that were blocked and banned for Magic Online because of this. And it's currently happening in Vintage. And there's an ongoing investigation because people are saying this other person, this username, they've done win trading before. So we think it's happening in Vintage right now.
You've got to be kidding.
I'm dead serious. Isn't
what's the edge here? Like, what do you actually like? What's the financial
game? I don't even really get it. Like, you have to make... Because it seems like you would have to queue up so much. I mean, there's a chance that the queues are so empty that it's just like really easy to do. But if your goal is to just get a bunch of QPs and not actually have to grind them.
What are QPs good for?
QPs let you play in the premier events on Magic Online. So if you want to play like the events that qualify you to the mocks, the events that qualify you to like any of like the premier level events that also happen on Magic Online. Oops, sorry. I shook the camera. But any of those things, basically it's a way you could enter a queue and almost certainly guarantee that you're going to get the QPs and make it a lot, like it might actually be easier to grind it out that way. But obviously it's really easy for Wizards to tell when this is happening because they're seeing that that like those people are like, it's always those two accounts paired against each other. Like it's not that hard to figure it out. Right.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Wow.
That
I don't know if I'm underestimating or overestimating the player base in terms of like what's worth the time and what's worth the doing.
That's wild to me is when I was talking to Luis because I was actually quizzing him on some of this stuff and he was like, oh, that one's real for sure. I remember that one in the Discord. And I'm like, whoa, he was aware because he is in the Vintage Discord too.
Oh my God.
Yeah.
That's insane. Wow. Yeah. Mind blown. I can't believe that one's real. That takes so much effort.
It's so much effort. But if you think about it, in some ways, it's kind of genius. Like I would have never realized that the way that you could confirm that they're definitely paired against each other is if they both do it at the same time. Like, yes, there's a chance you both accounts could find another opponent. But when you're playing in the Popper and the Vintage Cubes, if you never have, sometimes it takes like 5 minutes to find an opponent. There's just not that many people who play these formats. So you could guarantee that. Like it only works if you're doing something like an older format without that. You can't do it in modern.
Right, right. It can't be a robust queue.
Yeah. And on this note, and I don't have this as an extra conspiracy theories, there's also been a bunch of like, there's been a lot of people really kind of upset because people think that there's been a lot of win trading for trophy races. So because at some point some people get, for the record, you can get anything for being the trophy leader. You just get bragging rights. But there's been a lot of people who people have felt were like trying to bribe others just to get wins for the leaderboard, it's just, you don't literally don't get anything from it. But there's been multiple instances like this has happened in the Legacy queues where people were like, oh, the Legacy queue trophy race is really weird because there's definitely like people scooping to each other and stuff like that.
Wow.
Yeah. Isn't that surreal?
Jeez. Wow. I'm 0 for 2 on the real ones. Good God. Yeah. Okay.
All right, let me look at the next one. Oh, this one's good. All right, so this is one that believes that when you buy stuff from the Magic the Gathering Arena shop, your account gets flagged as like an active, like an engager, like somebody who's spending money. And if you do that, then you start getting put on the play more often. So...
So the more I spend on Arena...
So the more you spend on Arena, the more you get put on the play, and thus the more you win.
Oh my god. So now I'm gun shy. Like, I gotta.
You're
say
like,
yes
you're like, I want to say this is fake, but like the other ones were real.
It's like, I think. Oh my god.
All right, so I'm gonna give you a second to think about whether or not you think this one's real, and everyone at home too.
I cannot fathom that this would be a real thing. So here's the thing. It's not that I can't fathom it would be a real thing, because frankly, after everything we've already gone through, I can. I cannot fathom that there would ever be a legitimate form of confirmation on it. So because I think the proof just could never be there, I'm going to say that this is fake, or should I say unproven.
Unproven. Unproven. Unproven. All right. Ready for drum roll? You crushed it. That's exactly right. There is nothing to suggest that this is real other than people saying like, oh, weird how I bought the bundle and now I'm always in the play. Because people are like thinking about that stuff. And obviously, Arena never confirmed anything like that. It would also just weird if they actually confirmed something like that.
It would
that.
Be the end of the program.
Yes, it would just be a disaster.
Yeah.
It would just be a disaster. There's no way.
So there's no way we'll be able to prove it even if we know it's true.
Yeah. The funny thing about this one is that I've definitely seen like multiple people believe that this is true. And I always joke on my stream that like, oh man, we've been losing a lot today. Better go into the store and buy some cosmetics.
You should do that. Gabby,
you always need to do that.
And then then go buy something.
Yeah, sometimes I do that but I'm obviously just trolling, but it's like, it's so worth it because it's so ridiculous. Mm-hmm.
And you end up being on the play, Gabby?
Definitely not. We just keep...
Tune in to twitch.tv/GabbySparks.
To find out.
Yeah, you can find out more. God,
that one's such a banger. I love that one.
That one's great. The more you spend,
that one's so funny because it's also so ridiculous and it's so easy to make fun of. So... yeah, like it's actually been a joke where I'll go and then I'll just like buy like a pack or two just for kicks.
Just get in there. I've been buying a lot of stuff since I'm building on standard and I don't find myself on the play more. So you know what? I got to keep track now.
You got to keep track.
The more you know. Yeah. The more you know, everybody.
Every time you buy something, see if you're on the play next time. Exactly. And then you'll have a win streak.
Just last match won on the play. Last match won on the play. Last match won on the draw. Last match on the draw. So... we can do it.
All right. Next one. This conspiracy theory believes that all of these believe that Wizards is flagging accounts. Like that's the first thing, which there is nothing to suggest that. But people like all of these are, they all come from the same place that Wizards is like looking at something and they're flagging accounts based on that behavior. Mm-hmm. So this one believes that if you start winning too much on Arena, Wizards will flag your account as winning too much. And then what they'll do is when you're in the queue, they will try to pair you against your bad matchup to reduce your win rate.
Holy crap. Just like... wow.
All right. So I do want to point something out here with some of these. All these conspiracy theories don't really... mention why Wizards would do this. Like, there's nothing that, well, you know, like the one about, like the buying, one about you buying more, it's like floor. To encourage you to buy more, I guess. But all these other ones that are like, I'm always on the draw and Wizards flagged my account. There's never really a reason why they would like be trying to artificially like inflate or suppress your win rate. It just said, the conspiracies always just say, this is happening to me.
The ones that punish you just stone make no sense. There's no reason to punish you, to put you on the draw repeatedly. You can see because the whip isn't going to do it, but the carrot starts to make sense. In this case, though, like, and it's not even just about the flagging the account and what's the motivation. It's just like, let's just take a step back and ask ourselves the amount of work that has to go into, because we're not just talking about flagging people's accounts. We're talking about flagging a person's account and the deck they're playing right now. Like, I don't play a lot of standard. I have three decks. Okay. Three different decks. You don't know what I'm, you know. So Arena's watching me play. Arena's watching what deck I'm playing, watching how much I'm winning with that deck, making sure I'm not changing decks, and then matching me up with what it has somehow figured out. I mean, look, we lived through Throne of Eldraine draft. So it's not a bot determining what the good matchups and the bad matchups are. Can we at least agree with that?
Definitely. If there's 100% about definitely. That
bot, yeah, I'm in on it, right? Like, so basically, it's like this information is getting shot to that dark room in Renton. We're like, oh, yep, nope, Gabby's winning again. What's she on? Boral cycling? Okay, let's take a look here. We're gonna have to get on.
Give her fire. Some of that Bant Yorion. Make sure she's not winning.
Yeah, she needs Bant Yorion right now. Stat. Who's playing Bant Yorion? You know. So yeah, no, I'm a hard pass on this. There is absolutely no way. Just because, you know what? Even if they wanted to do it, I just don't think the technology's there. I just don't think it's actually technologically possible to achieve this.
All right, ready for the verdict?
Yep.
So fake. Oh my gosh, I can't believe people believe this. It's crazy. Unbelievable.
This one's crazy.
Part of the thing too is what you said. Look, Wizards is already preoccupied enough with Q health. Like that's one of their big metrics. They're always, whenever they introduce a new format, a new like special event, cube draft, cube sealed, any of that stuff. One of the things that they're always like looking and monitoring to make sure is working well is Q health. Q health basically means that I go into a match and I get paired up against somebody who is of my same rank or of my same record. Whatever the format dictates is the way you get paired in that format, because it does vary by format. And they're just trying to make sure that you get the best pairing based on your current ranking and your current record, right? And if you think that there's an extra element of them analyzing your deck and what the bad matchup is and pairing you up for no real reason, by the way, there's nothing to indicate why Wizards would want to do this, just that that some people think it's happening. So they're now, all...
Is this constructed only too? I have to imagine.
People think it's with constructed only. And I will say this. To give some benefit of the doubt to the people who actually believe this, is some queues on Arena do pair you based on card quality, but it's only one queue, and it's like the player, like it's the just for fun lobby, basically.
Got it.
So yeah. The just for fun lobby used to exist in Magic Online. It actually doesn't exist anymore. But the whole point of that lobby was that you could just bring anything you wanted, and you like it was kind of like frowned upon for you to bring like a try hard deck to the just for fun lobby. It was supposed to be a place where new players could kind of like learn the rules or try new decks or try new brews. And Magic Arena has the unranked play queue for like a while. I actually don't know if it still does this, but when Arena first launched, it actually did take a look at your whole deck and saw which cards you were playing. And if you were playing a bunch of cards that were like really janky, it would try to pair you up against another deck that was also playing really janky cards. That was actually a thing that existed. Yeah, I don't. It might still exist.
Partially there.
Yeah,
it's kind of there.
It's a little bit there, but the conspiracy theory, the one that I heard, is when I'm trying to rank up, Wizards doesn't let me rank up fast enough. They want to make sure that I'm not winning enough, so that I have to play more Magic. Like that was supposed to be like where it came from. So I am giving a little bit of the benefit of the doubt to the people who believe it, because there is actually something on Arena that kind of does that. Yeah.
Let me you've brought a question out of my mind. Do you know how big the jump can be? Like if I'm at bronze, in the pairing algorithm, like how high up can my opponent be?
So it depends on which queue you're playing. Because some queues will, like, for example, I think Magic Online only pairs by record. So you know if you're playing against the person who is, like, 2-0 or something, like, they probably have a decent deck. And you don't always get put up, like, if you're 2-0, you don't always get paired up against another 2-0. Sometimes you get paired against, right, like, a 1-1. That does happen. Sure. But in Arena... And on the dev forums, you can actually see each queue and where you're supposed to, who you're supposed to get paired with. So, and they all work differently because like Premier Draft works different than just best of one draft against bots, because they want to make sure that like they basically decided that different formats should pair you against different people, because some formats will be more punishing if you get paired up against just the record. Because it means that the deck you're playing against probably has like 2L spets or something. Whereas if you get paired by rank, then you're probably playing somebody who's of similar skill level and whatever deck they drafted.
Yeah. Because I just noticed, because I'm a bronze
Me, a lowly bronze player.
And I got paired up against a gold level player, and I was like, wait, what's
you're like weird. Why did this happen? Okay.
Yeah.
So that was a perfect segue into our next conspiracy theory. Mm-hmm. It's perfect. Nice. It's perfect.
Okay, right. Okay.
So this conspiracy theory thought the following. You remember when they rolled out premiered best of one draft?
Yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So historically, you are supposed to get paired against people in a close rank to you, right?
Sure.
So yeah. if you're a plat, usually you're playing against another plat player, or maybe you're playing against diamond, which means you got paired up, or maybe mm-hmm. you're playing against gold, so you got a little paired down. But that's totally fine. One of the things that games do in general is when you fail to matchmake within the first like X amount of time, they broaden the parameters so that you get paired up against someone, because they don't want to keep you waiting in a queue forever, right? So if they first couldn't immediately find somebody to pair you against like your rank, then maybe they'll make it wider and see if you find somebody in either diamond or bronze or gold to try to pair sure. you up.
Just reach it down, right?
Right. Up, yeah. So, and then they keep expanding it until you eventually like create the match. And that's a thing that happens. And this is not just on Magic Online or Arena or this is a thing that happens in games and like matchmaking. Mm-hmm. So what people were believing is that when they launched Premier Draft, one of the things that happened is they were seeing themselves get paired against record or like against ranks that didn't make any sense. So mm-hmm. what you were saying, like, weird, I'm copper or like I'm bronze, but I got paired against somebody in diamond. How, like, why did that happen? Sure. I'm supposed to be getting paired against somebody in my rank. Why am I playing against somebody who's so high rank? And then mm-hmm. the other thing that people were noticing was, do you know about hand smoothing?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Where it looks at both hands and then gives you the best one,
yeah.
right?
So the best of one formats on Arena have this thing called hand smoothing. Just to explain to anybody who's listening to the podcast and doesn't know, what hand smoothing basically does is, you know, if you're playing a game of Magic, you open up your seven and then you decide to keep or maul and then you go to six, right? Hand smoothing, what it did is it looked at two versions of your deck. It would look at mm-hmm. 2 7 card hands. It would do this in the back end. You don't get to see this at all.
You don't get to see it.
Yeah, nope. you don't get to see it. It just happens at the beginning of the game. It looks at two hands, compares them, and it takes basically the better of the two hands. And I'm not even going to go into the nitty gritty of like what that algorithm looks like, because they've changed it a lot and I don't actually know what it's updated to. But usually it would always try to give you like two lands and spells.
I think that's the big that's the big thing I always think is like, if it's a no lander and a two lander, you're going to look at the two lander. Like,
yeah.
I think land count is a big part.
Yeah, that's a really big part of it. And so people have come to expect that when you're playing the best of one formats, because you're only playing one game, what they're trying to do is minimize the amount of times you get mana screwed. So that's mm-hmm. why this hand smoothing exists. So when Premier Draft rolled out, people said, weird, I'm getting paired up against people that are like way out of my rank, and I should be getting paired against people that are my rank, because it was ranked draft. And mm-hmm. and then the other thing that people noticed is, weird, I feel like I'm getting really mana screwed in these games. I wonder what's happening.
Okay.
All right, so is this one real or not?
Oh, okay, so the conspiracy is the hand smoother wasn't working at first, and the rankings didn't work. They weren't pairing correctly.
The conspiracy was yes to what you're saying, but the conspiracy basically was, Wizards told us that this is how this draft format's going to work, but that's not my experience of how it's working. Are they lying to us about it?
Wow. Okay, let me think about this.
Yeah.
So my inclination is to say that this is fake, but every time it's like a borderline thing and I say it's fake, it's real. It's like, okay, did the hand smoother not work at first? People weren't challenging. I'm going to say this is real. God, this one's going to be fake, isn't it? I bit at the wrong time, but I'm going to say this happened. There were some bugs in the rollout. That's, oh God, I know what's happening here. I said no twice and they were both yeses. And now this one should be.
You're like, I'm going to feel so dumb when this one's actually real. And it's the.
Yeah. So, all right.
Is that the verdict?
This was legit. This did happen. This was a bug. I'm going to say there was a rollout problem when this got introduced.
All right, ready? Drum roll. You're right. This was real. This did actually happen. And the way people found out was later when in the like dev forums, Watsy basically said, hey, we fixed this. It wasn't supposed to be like that.
Yeah.
So they said that. So they had two developers notes that said the following. As some of you may have noticed, there were certain scenarios where you were being matched against somebody with a much higher or lower rank than yours. And this is adjusted rank-based matchmaking for Premier Draft. It was for this in particular. This should address that issue. Regardless, players were still being properly matched based on the current win-loss record. Rank draft formats use both rank and your win-loss record for searching for an opponent. That's what I was saying by, like, they start broadening the parameters. So in the beginning, people noticed that they were getting paired, like, way out of their league. And it was because you were getting paired against just record, which means that if you happen to be like 7-1 or 6-1 in a draft, you could get paired against like number 7 mythic and you could be bronze, and that actually could have happened. And so that's why people noticed that it was being weird, because they were like, no, this is too weird, I'm getting paired way too far out of my rank. And then the second part of it was adjustments to opening hand algorithm for Premier Draft. Developers note, we intend for best of one formats to use modified opening hand algorithm, which pulls multiple opening hands and chooses one. Premier Draft was operating contrary to that, and we have fixed it accordingly. To stave off any conspiracy theories, they literally say this.
Oh my God, too late.
It was previously using our best of three opening hand rules, which pulls one and only one opening hand.
And that's actually kind of where I got buy-in on this, is because I don't think the thing about, so I knew about the hand smoothing because I was playing a lot of mono red. And you intentionally in the constructed, in the ranked constructed queues, what you intentionally were doing is cutting your land count and just saying, hey, smooth it out for me, baby. I'm gonna get less lands. And I don't think that people adjusted their draft tendencies in land counts to do that. So if they were getting land light in that situation, my gut was like, okay, there was a problem.
No, that's a good read, because for maybe some people who didn't know, when Arena was first out, like within its first year or something, there was a mono red deck that was the best deck by a lot. And this is back when Wizards was still developing their queues. So the only way you could rank up was in best of one ranked constructed in standard. And the one thing that kept happening in this format was people were only playing mono red. So all you could ever play when you get in the queues was mono red. And the other thing is, an alternate version of that deck was made that was like 13 land mono red for specifically constructed. Because what they would do is they would add just a ton of one drops in a 60 card deck and only 13 lands. And because a hand smoother existed, you would almost always get two lands in your opening hand, which meant that you couldn't really flood out. So people were, as it turns out, the deck wasn't better than just a regular mono red deck. Like,
regular mono red better.
It was still just better. But this was the thing. Like, people for a while were trying to see if, and for the first Mythic Invitational, people were like, I wonder if we should run like the weird 13 land mono red deck, because maybe we can take advantage of the hand smoother.
So no, don't do that. It wasn't a good thing.
No.
But yeah. Footnote. Don't worry, I crushed the gold player. That's what triple Zenith Flare will do for you. You can't lose. You just can't lose. So.
That card is very stupid in draft. It's really, really good.
I did end up turn someone, just no one wants to hear about your draft, but Zenith Flare is so good. I had, my buddy was at 18, had total dominance, was playing a mutate deck, and I was
just
die
like
next
do it
turn.
Over two turns and kill them.
End of turn, take 10, untap, take 10. Good game. It's just like stupid. Card's stupid. Anyway, all right.
That's really good.
I got one right. I'm so happy.
Yes,
with
myself. You crushed that one. I mean, you got a lot of the fake ones too, but that's the first one that was real that you actually thought was real.
Basically, I've been on mono. Nope. Like, this is the first time.
It's
just
easy to say no to these, because for so many of these, it's people not wanting to take responsibility in their own decisions. It's a lot easier to say that you got screwed because your account got flagged than you played poorly and you lost.
Yeah, or the pros are just better.
Yeah, right? or the pros clearly had to, clearly their scouting is better, and that's why they're doing better at the pro tour. And it's like, yeah, maybe they have scouting teams, like that's a thing, but also they're just better players than the average player because they play professionally. Like, put two and two together here.
There's a correlation there.
Yeah.
All right. Another one?
Yeah. Okay. This one, I don't even really need to ask you if you think it's true or not, because it's so ridiculous, but I had to mention it because it's a big thing I've seen in a lot of places. Ready?
Okay.
Arena was introduced to kill paper magic / Magic Fest Online was CFB's attempt to kill paper magic.
Wow.
That was...
I haven't heard this
one. You hadn't heard this one? This is the thing.
I've heard the arena thing. I've never heard Magic Fest Online as part of it.
Really? I've seen that in multiple places. And every time, I just wanted to be like, I don't know if you noticed, pal, but paper magic is dead right now. It just is dead right now.
Yeah,
you think the company that sells magic cards, paper magic cards for a business, wants to start a tournament series to kill paper magic? Like, oh my God.
We have a warehouse full of inventory,
right,
that I can drive.
That's the thing that frustrated me so much about those comments. It was like, wait a second. If you just think about it for 2 seconds, you can realize that this is not the case. But
no.
Yeah. People had to figure out that there was something malicious about Magic Fest Online, which is really cool, by the way. You should totally try it.
So before I tell you how fake and wrong this is, I'd like a list of all the people who have commented on Final Fireballs in Baltimore here, just to verify with them that this
just,
is all fake.
Just to know. Just to clear the record.
But I assure you, it's totally fake, and not to worry about it. No, this is fake. I mean, I the arena stuff we heard a lot of, right? But
yeah.
I will say this on the, like, Channel Fireball side of it and the Superstar side of it, because Magic Online's been around for longer than Channel Fireball, and the TO side of it, the CFB event side, like, every time a digital product is introduced, be it Magic Online, be it Duel the Planeswalkers, be it Arena, more people play live Magic. Like, it is truly a rising tide scenario. Mm-hmm. So just right off the bat, whether a product is introduced like Arena because Wizards wants to lateral to that instead of paper magic. I mean, I'm not going to speak to the motivations there. I think that's insane. And no one at Wizards that I know would ever feel that way, because, by the way, they make a lot of money on paper magic. Maybe not today, maybe not right now. But the idea that somehow this digital product is going to kill paper magic is just, like, empirically untrue. More people play paper magic when there's a digital product. That's just it.
Yeah.
Like,
the digital portion of it, there's a lot of people, and even, like, anecdotally speaking, at the last couple of Grand Prix that I've gone to, I've met so many people who started playing on Arena, and this was their first Grand Prix. Like, they learned that there was this cool circuit of tournaments, mm-hmm, with real physical cards, and they were like, wow, that's really cool, because people get used to seeing CCGs online and know that these cards don't exist in the real world. They're cards in your digital game, which is cool. It's fine. But... even, like, I went to FNM here in Denver a couple times, and I've met a couple people who started playing on Magic Arena, and they're now coming to their first FNM. Like, it has become a really big funnel to get people from digital to paper magic and actually buying boosters, spending money, and doing all that stuff. So,
no, it's awesome.
Yeah, I think it's great, but it is really funny when the other people are like, oh, this is definitely done. This is the end of paper magic. I'm calling it.
How did they figure it out? I mean, yeah. Totally fake. Totally fake.
Gosh, that one's really good. That's another popular one. The MFO Online is just like, you should really just take a look at what the current situation is, because this is trying to keep tournament magic alive. It's not trying to kill it.
We have a lot of paper product, trust me. We don't want it to go away.
All right. So then the next few ones are not really like a yes or no quiz, but they're things that I had to mention if we were doing a conspiracy theory episode. Okay. First one is, the shuffler algorithm is definitely wrong posts. To give you an example of how common of a thing this is, I actually thought about pulling out excerpts from this thing, and I couldn't even really do it because everything just sounds like a bad beat story. It's always, I can't believe that I was doing so well, then I flooded out. I can't believe that I've played Magic for 20 years, and in my entire 20 years playing, I've never gotten as mana screwed as I got when I play Magic Arena or when I... Yeah, but they're wild. Like, they're all bad beat stories. Like, when you read every single one of them, they're just bad beat stories. There is a post on the MTG Arena forum, the dev forum, that has the title of it is literally, let me load it up. The random shuffle algorithm is definitely wrong. It has 500,000 views and 11,000 posts in it. It's just a random thread under general I am dead serious. And I'm going to include it in the show notes. And if you just... It's just a great read, honestly. It's all Bad Beat stories. And people use that as evidence that it's clearly broken, because how could you have been playing Magic for 20 years and only gotten this Mana screwed on Arena? Like, that is just a really
good I have an answer to that. And this goes back to where we started the show. Guess what? You're really bad at randomizing your deck.
Yeah.
You're really bad at shuffling. You know what I mean? Like, you're not actually randomizing your deck. That's why you haven't had these experiences before. Because, I mean, you've got to sufficiently randomize. And if you don't, guess what? These things don't happen to you because you haven't really shuffled your deck well. But guess what? Arena does. And that's what the experience is like.
And people also, by the way, if you like take a look at that thread, you don't see that people saying like, holy moly, I would have 100% lost that hand if I didn't immediately draw a red source on that specific turn. And I did. You don't see the people saying that. You just see the people saying, no, I flooded and I got mana screwed. There's never anyone who ever got bailed out and then they were like really lucky. So that I'll make sure to include that in the show notes. It's a really good one.
Yeah, but you need to start that thread.
Where are all my peeps of like, I got lucky and I actually won the game? Yeah, where are those people?
Well, see, you can't make it positive. You have to keep it negative. Yes, the shuffler's definitely broken. I top deck 3 matches in a row and won because of the shuffler. So you still have to be complaining about the shuffler and how bad the shuffler is. And you should have lost these matches. You stole these games because the shuffler's broken. And that's how you
win. That's honestly the best part about some of these conspiracy theories, is that these conspiracy theories only negatively affect you. Somehow the shuffler being broken, that's not true for anyone else. That's just true for you. And that's why people get salty. And it's like, no, wait, if the shuffler really truly were broken, it would overall be a wash, because everybody out there would also be getting screwed by the shuffler. So wouldn't half like
it, no.
If it were broken, it would be completely even.
No, my account was tagged because I was winning too much.
Because so you weren't buying enough cards. Then I got
in the broken shuffler queue. So you're not paying attention to this, Gabby, because I'm going to tell you something. You're looking at all of this in isolation. Wizards is tagging our accounts. They know what decks we're playing. They know what cards we need on a given turn, and they know what our bad matchups are. Okay, all of these things are obviously tied together. So, and that's why the only way you can find any success in these digital mediums is to have 2 dummy accounts that you play against each other.
And concede to each other.
All I'm trying to do is balance the scales, Gabby. Don't you see? Like, you got to take a stand somewhere, and this is it. They're tagging our accounts. They're watching our games. They know what cards we need and what cards we don't need. And by the way, I don't know why they're tagging. They have to be tagging my account because they're clearly not doing that to my opponent, because the shuffler is screwing me.
And never them.
To give my opponent
only me.
Yeah, right. It's like, let's remember, whatever's happening in a game of Magic that you think is hurting you is benefiting the person on the other side of the table, right?
Yeah,
like,
always. Just whenever you get salty, know that the other person got very lucky.
Yeah, exactly. So it's like it's not just the Wizards has created this to hurt everyone, because that's just not possible. Every game of Magic has a winner, right? Every match has a winner. Well, I guess there's ties. Okay, there's draws. I get that. But just the idea that, oh, they're doing this to punish us and everybody's getting punished.
It's so funny. This is part of the reason I love these conspiracy theories so much. They make me so happy because they're so ridiculous. All right.
Unbelievable.
There's 2 that are worth mentioning. Like I said, these aren't like, I'm going to quiz you on it. They're obviously just nonsense, but.
Get us our quick hits if you want.
These are the quick hits. So this is the first one. Someone who shall remain unnamed believes that Wizards flags accounts so that they never open power in Vintage Cube.
That's the best theory ever.
It's so good.
Is there any way that I could lobby for that to just be, please be true?
That would be funny if they could actually do that. That would be a good troll.
I'll bet you that GoFundMe would get astronomically high.
Make it so they flag just a few accounts so they never open. Like,
hey, you know what? It'll just be 1 account, please, Wizards of the Coast. And I'll leave that account nameless. But oh my God, it would be so hilarious.
So good.
Only if we can guarantee everyone else opened power.
Oh, there you go. Everybody else gets power and the one person never gets power. Love
it. Yes. Oh God, that'd be solid gold. So
this is the very last one. And the original conspiracy theory.
Okay.
It's the whitelist. So for those who are not familiar with the whitelist is basically the idea that if you like know people at Wizards or know somebody there, or you're a streamer or you're a like magic writer or are connected in some way, you talk to somebody at Wizards to make sure that you draw the right cards exactly when you need them, and you always open bangers in your draft. So
and hashtag blame Worth.
And yes, so that's the other thing I wanted to mention is this originates sometimes, like a lot of this comes back to Worth Wolpert. That's how you say his last name, right?
Is it, I think, like, so. That's how
Wolpert or Wolpert? Yeah. He used to be like the head of Magic Online, basically. And for doing that, he actually could do something pretty special, which happened to me when I first started streaming, and it happened to a bunch of other streamers back then. He could actually put cards in your account. So sometimes if you were streaming, you would suddenly get a dialogue box that showed up and it just said, like, these cards, like, are now in your account. And they I'm dead serious. And they never did, like, valuable cards. Like, one of the things I got one time was 500 Ambush Vipers, which are obviously a common that's worth, like, a cent. If that. Like,
that's awesome. You have 500 plus Ambush Vipers on your Moto.
And there were multiples. Like, there were foils. They were just, like, that's normal ones. Sweet. Yeah, and I got those from Worth, like, because he was watching the stream and he dropped that in there. And that's happened. If you ask a lot of the, like, more old school Magic players, the ones that, streamers specifically, the ones that stream Magic Online, a lot of them have gotten gifts from Worth. So then this is where, like, the whole whitelist was born. And the idea was, like, Worth, please, one time, I really need to draw this land. And then the joke is you do draw it, and they're like, somebody at Wizards is watching. They just wanted to make sure I drew it right.
Oh, my God.
Luis even has an emote on his stream that's called the whitelist, and it's just like a scroll that just says whitelist and it sparkles, because the idea is, like, that's the only way you could have drawn, like, the exact card you needed. Like, you were gonna die and you drew the Wrath, or you were gonna get mana screwed but you drew the perfect land, or you were playing a tricolor deck and you drew your splash color untapped. Like, that's the concept of the whitelist. That's the whitelist trademark is the original conspiracy theory.
That is insane. I just want to say, and you can ask Raptor about this, and this is really, really true. I've seen Luis do this many, many times. The draft cabal and top decking to win the game, like, top decking to win the game is, like, a real thing for someone like me, because I sometimes need a top deck to win the game. Ask Josh Utter-Layton about the best match in Magic he ever saw. It was Paul Rietzel playing, I think it was playing white-red during Zendikar. I think it was an aggro, the white-red, like, you know, a landfall, aggro landfall.
Yeah.
And he talks about how Paul, from the get-go, from turn one, was playing perfect Magic. He was constantly putting himself in a position to win every turn. And I'm like, and he said it was, like, the best match of Magic, well, the best game of Magic he'd ever seen. I'm like, oh, sweet, Paul won. He goes, oh, no, he got ranched. He got destroyed. But the fact is, good players, and I've seen Luis do this so many times, whether they're in a winning position or a losing position, they're always putting themselves in a position to maximize that draw, right? Like, and you know what? Go watch Kyoto again. Nassif's only vote was that freaking cruel ultimatum, and he was playing to draw it, and when he did, he won. So it really undermines the value. Like, for someone like I do not have the skill level to play Magic like that, where I am constantly playing to that out and I have the vision for what that out is. So I do need Worth to send me that.
Just ship some cards, Worth, please. Right.
But you're undermining, honestly, like, in a serious note, on a conspiracy episode, like, watch some good Magic players play and understand what the goal is. And you'll see, like, it's not just luck. They've put themselves in a position to maximize the value on that top deck. And that's perfect Magic. That's when you see Magic.
Yeah,
and,
you know. No, to this point, and obviously not getting too deep into it because this is not a strategic podcast. Mm-hmm. This is the one about conspiracy theories. But one of the things that actually also is kind of a little bit of a conspiracy theory out there is people think there's, like, streamer privilege is a real thing, where, like, you do seem to draw the things you want more often than people, like, playing at home feel like they do. And it's exactly what you said right now. Like, this happens on my stream all the time, because when I'm playing, I have my deck list here on the other side, and they'll say, okay, well, we're playing with a plan, right? We're playing to... the only way we can really make a comeback this game is if we draw this into this. And so you should, because you're otherwise dead, you have to play to that out. Yep. And sometimes that means that you make blocks and attacks that are kind of weird, because you're assuming that the next card you draw is that card, because otherwise you feel like you never had a shot in the first place. Mm-hmm. And people always say this, and they say this in Luis's stream all the time, and I picked this habit up from him. When you are constantly calling the cards that you need, when you draw them, it's so sick, because you're like, the only way this works is if I draw this now, and then boom, you draw the card, and people are like, oh my God, that's amazing. But it wasn't actually that amazing. You just looked at a list of cards. You figured out the two that actually get you out of a situation. Mm-hmm. You're like, blood curdle, bam. And then boom, you draw it. And it looks like cool entertainment on television. But really, all you were doing is looking at the cards that you needed to get out of a situation and playing with a plan.
But it turns out the whole time, Worth
was watching. Worth.
He was watching too. And maybe he nudged you in the right direction. He's like, what card is she calling for? Okay. Brr, boom.
Yeah. Blood curdle. Like, boom.
I don't remember drafting this. Oh, well.
You're like, it's sweet. It's in my deck. I don't know. Cast it.
Well, this has been a long time coming. I was actually happy for the slow news week. This was great. This format was unbelievable, Gabby.
Yeah, so much fun. I love. Thanks again to everybody in my Discord who helped me put this together. You're the real MVP. But these are amazing. I love them so much. They're so great.
We're gonna have to do this again once we.
Well, let some conspiracies pile up. I'll have a document ready to go, and then we'll do the part two boogaloo.
We'll run it again. I can't wait for that. But until then, or I should say, until next week. I'm Mashi Scanlon, at Mashi Scanlon across all social media platforms. She is at Gabby Sparks across all social media platforms. We are at Magic FM Podcast on Twitter. Check that out. Don't forget, you can watch the video. And this is one I would say you want to watch the video on this.
Yeah, Mashi and I were like losing it in this episode.
Yeah, it was so good. You can check that out on channelfireball.com or YouTube, where we post the videos, this stuff. Until next week, thank you so much for tuning in. Stay safe out there. Be wonderful to yourselves and be wonderful to each other.
Bye-bye.